Greetings, my people of Earth. Paul Muckle here again. Today is June 10th, 2011 at 12:31 a.m. Eastern Time. I was just born. Today is my birth date. I was born on this day, right around this time, around 12:30, 12:28 I think, 12:30. I was born. Anyway, greetings my people, and I come today to give you a birthday gift. You see, you don't have to give me any gift because you have given me, those of you who support me, and have given me your love. That was the gift I have asked of any man. Just your support and your love. Just for you to give me a chance. Give me a chance to prove to you that I'm for real. That's all I've asked, and very few of you did. And the few of you that did, you gave me enough love. Enough love to survive to see my birth date. Because without your love and support, I don't know if I would have survived the onslaught that Babylon took against me. So, here's my gift back to you. And because of your love and support, millions more shall reap the benefit. Because on this day, I'm happy to tell you all people that, as those of you who follow me know, I've been fighting in the federal court against all the banks, accusing them of committing mortgage and securities fraud against all the people, and for destroying the United States economy. And I sue them and ask the government to help me to fight for all the people, because I was under the belief that all the people got taken advantage of. But instead of helping me to fight for the people, the government took it upon themselves, including the Attorney General Office of Massachusetts, Martha Coakley's office, took it upon herself to prosecute me, to do everything in the upper to get me to drop the case against these banks. So, what have we here? I turned around and I sue them. I sue all 50 governors of all 50 states, and I sue the federal government, which is the United States of America, George Bush, Barack Obama, the Treasury Secretaries, and the SEC Chairman. Why did I sue them? I sue the states because the states are responsible for passing their laws, and the laws of every state, and the laws of every state in the union. Okay, a mortgage company have no authority, no standing to foreclose on your property unless the name is on the title. Unless they have ownership to the property, they have no right to foreclose on it. And not one single one of these banksters who have been foreclosing on your property, not one of them, not one single one of them have title to your property. They committed fraud. These are mortgage loans assigned in blanks, which means they are assigned to the air, to nothing. Okay? It's all a fraudulent thing. That's why American economy fell, because it was all fraud. So, so I sued the government. So the judges of each state are responsible for following the law. And the judges knew, they knew that the banks had no authority to foreclose on your property because they didn't have ownership. But the judges still gave out millions upon millions upon millions of foreclosure orders. These clerks and these judges, knowing that they were breaking the law. So now, Massachusetts Supreme Court heard a case, Ibanez, I think it is, versus U.S. Bank National Associates. And there was another case in Florida, Fourth District Appeals Court. I don't remember the name off the top of my head, but I'll find it later. I think Gissep or something like that, but I'll find it later. and both of these courts found that these banks committed fraud. They found that these banks didn't have ownership, titleship to the property. And Massachusetts court ruled that we have a long standing that assignment doesn't convey ownership to a property. And the Massachusetts Supreme Court ruled that in their rush to sell mortgage-backed securities, the banks committed fraud. So people, every single home that have been foreclosed on since Bush came into office until now are all fraudulent. Every single last one of them are all fraudulent. And every single mortgage collection, every single dollar you have paid these banks, every single one of it is like, it's like you're paying an illegal fee. So therefore, these banks under the law have to return all your money. Okay, I'm going a little bit too fast. Excuse me. So these state judges knew they were breaking the law. They knew they were violating the Constitution. They were giving away your property without due process. Okay? And they kept silent. And Paul Merkel found them out. And I went to the authorities. And the authorities prosecuted me. Threatened me. Threatened to put me in jail. Threatened to take away my kids. Left my kids in lead poison for 8 months. They did, people, if you only know half the story, these people did to me and my children just to get me to drop this case. You know what I told them? Even if you paid me $100 million to drop this case, I would not do it. Because I knew I was onto something. I knew. Because my Lord showed it to me. Since 1993, He showed this to me. And I'll tell you all the full story one day. Which I did before, but none of you were listening. Most of you wasn't even listening. Some did, but most of you wasn't. But anyway. The government of Massachusetts began to prosecute me. A judge even threatened me. Oh, you want to fight the government? Let's see if you can win. And I have him on tape. I have these people on tape. Threatening me. Bribing me. Okay. Promising that they'll fix my house for my kids if I drop the case against this bank. The government of Massachusetts, the Attorney General office, promised me on tape people, promising me that telling to the judge, if Mr. Merkel will drop this case against the banks, he could get some money to fix up his house so his children can come home. Okay? Those are the things that these people did to me, and I have it all on tape. All on tape. So, no one can say I'm lying. I record everything. Okay. So anyway, since they want to prosecute me, okay. So I sued them. I sued all 50 governors and Barack Obama and George Bush. So the reason why I sued the 50 governors was because they were responsible for the state judges giving out these unlawful foreclosure orders. So the state, if a state governor is noticing that, wait a minute, how come my citizens are losing their house by the hundreds of thousands and by the millions? How come, something ain't right here. That governor has a responsibility to investigate. And in his investigation as executive of the state, it is his responsibility to realize that these banksters do not have ownership to this property they're foreclosing on. All they have is an assignment. They are only allowed to collect mortgage payments. They're not allowed to foreclose on your property and sell it. There's a difference between an assignment and a conveyance. A conveyance of title means that the title was signed over to them. But the title is not signed over to anybody because They don't want anyone to know who owned this property, because Mr. Rothschild, the man behind the curtain, the wizard behind the curtain, he owns your mortgages. But he don't want you all to know, so they are assigned in blank. See? He doesn't exist. So his name doesn't exist on your mortgages, and no one name exists on there. Okay? He's the wizard behind the curtains, the magician. Okay? So no one owns it. You own your mortgage but you. You're the only person who owns your mortgage. You're the only person who owns title to your home. You. So your property belongs to you. So these judges were giving out unlawful orders for foreclosure when the banks didn't own your property. No one owned it but you. So only you have a right to foreclose and sell your own property. All they have a right to do is collect mortgage payments. So I sued the governors for failure in their duty to police their judges and to take responsibility for their citizens. Then I sued Bush and Obama for violating the 14th Amendment, Section 4, which said, I don't remember it off the top of my head, I'll find it after I make the speech, I'm going to add it in, but I think it says something like, the debt, it's about, okay, I'm going to put it in the words so I can understand, right? The government cannot pay, let's say, the banks, right, coming straight against all the people, right? Intentionally, and these are foreign banks, they are Mr. Rothschild banks, they are banks from France, they are Credit Suisse, okay, Dutch Bank, okay, Societe Generale, okay, these are foreign banks. So let's say these banks come into our country and come and fight against all the people and cause all the chaos they're causing. That's an insurrection. They have committed an aggressive act against the people. It's an insurrection, and the Constitution, the 14th Amendment, Section 4, speak about if, because the banks, right, committed fraud against all the people, and they lose a lot of money because people couldn't afford to pay their mortgages, the government is not permitted to pay the debt of these banks for their loss. Bush had no authority under the United States Constitution to bail out the banks, because the banks were the ones responsible for the fraud against the people. So he violated the 14th Amendment, Section 4. He paid the debt of the ones who caused the destruction to the United States economy. Mr. Obama had no authority to continue the top bailout either. He had no authority to do that, because these banks, including GM and all of them, GM was involved in the mortgage too, GMAC, okay, they were involved in mortgage too, that's why they failed. So Mr. Obama had no right to bail out GM, no matter if GM are creating jobs now. You should have owned it, not bailed it out, and give them another chance. If you're gonna bail them out, then guess what? The people should own them. You want about socialism? If you're gonna keep leaving the fox in the hen house, what the hell you think gonna keep happening? Huh? It's like the bird that keep laying its egg in the viper's den. The bird that allow the viper to lay its eggs in her nest. Because what gonna happen? When the eggs are hatched, you know, the baby viper, they're going to eat up the young chickens. They're going to eat up the young birds. And when the fish eating up all the young birds and they get hungry, they're going to eat up the bird too. Okay? So therefore, if GM and all these companies had a hand in destroying America's economy, then you shouldn't bail them out and give them back the reins again. Because that's just like putting the viper's egg in the bird's nest all over again. Soon as they hatch, soon as no one is looking, we think it's peace and safety, they're just gonna rise up and eat us up again. Okay? Those who don't learn from history are bound to repeat it. So, I sue Bush and Obama and Geithner for bailing out the crooks, violating the United States Constitution, Section 14, Amendment Section 4. And I sue the SEC chairman because they turn a blind eye while trillions upon trillions dollars worth of worthless securities were attached to our family homes. The SEC, they didn't look. They weren't looking. They were too busy watching porno flick. Okay? That's what they were busy doing. And they got a pass. No one got prosecuted. All this crime, Goldman Sachs, AIG, everyone know they commit crime against the people. But no one got prosecuted. So, what have we here now? Am I going to just look at that, knowing that these people commit crime against the people? I'm supposed to just look at that, take briberies, just fight for myself? Me, a person who loves fans, who when I was a child, I got bullied so much when I was a child, okay? I'm not going to lie, I got bullied a lot when I was a child, okay? Because I was so peaceful. And I guess the people didn't like me as a peaceful person, so they used to bully me. You know what I'm saying? And I know what it's like to be on the bottom. I know what it's like to be poor. I know what it's like not to have. Okay? I grew up in a two-room shack. Okay? A room with my grandmother, my brothers and sisters. One room, all of us, bundled up in that room. I walk barefooted. I wear second hand clothes. And the point I'm trying to make, I know what it's like not to have. And it's not a good thing. It's a very sad thing. It's a painful thing. And I realize that in order for me to be happy, my children to be happy, then we can't be the only one to have. The people around us must have to. For my children to survive and not be envied by other people, then other people must have equally as my children. It's right and it's fair, because the world is no man's world. It's for all of us. And I think that if a man can stand up and really believe truly, truly in his heart, deep in his heart, truly, truly believe that he can make a change, and he really gonna try to make a change for all equally, and not just for himself or for his family, but equally for all, that he could really call on the powers of the universe to fight with him. And I truly believe that's what I have done. So I sued Bush and Obama and all of them. And as you all know, the judge in the district court, Judge Douglas P. Woodlock, he intervened for the government. He didn't even allow them to answer. He didn't even allow them to be served. He forgot all about the separation of powers. You know how it's supposed to be: the judiciary, the executive, and the legislative, something like that. And there's separation of powers. So the court not supposed to rule on behalf, if someone sue the government to seek redress, the court not supposed to intervene at all, except to allow the case to proceed. The court cannot intervene and say, okay, well, let me do a preliminary thing of this case. No, because if the court not going to do a preliminary, if I sue someone for medical malpractice, the court not going to do a preliminary. The court is going to serve the person, Therefore, why is the court doing a preliminary for the government? No, that's again, that's unconstitutional. So what Judge Woodlock did, he intervened, he overstepped the separation of powers, and he acted as if I sued him. And he ruled on behalf of the government and threw them out, saying I have no standing to sue the government. And all kind of mumbo jumbo, non-legal. I mean, even a high school student could have read a better decision. Honestly, I mean, honestly, Judge Woodlock should be ashamed of himself. Okay, even a high school student could write a better decision than what this man wrote. It's the most ridiculous legal opinion I've ever read, and it's going to go down in history as the most ridiculous, the most shameful, the most idiotic decision ever came out of the District Court of Massachusetts, out of the federal court period. History going to look at this decision, they're going to laugh at it, and they're going to say, this is what not to be like. This is the man who not to be like. They're going to make an example out of this man, because he has ridiculed and he has made a total mockery of the justice system. So anyway, he intervened and didn't allow the case to go to the defendant. He intervened and overstepped his authority and found on behalf of the defendant, on behalf of George Bush, on behalf of Barack Obama and the governors. And guess what? George Bush Senior appointed him. So these people already had their little, see, they knew, it's like they knew into the future, they knew Paul was coming to fight them, so they already have this man already there to intervene on behalf of them. I'm not afraid to talk, because I'm not afraid of Judge Woodlock. Okay, I speak truth. I'm not speaking truth, I'm not afraid of any man. All he could do is send his goon to arrest me. That's all he could do. Okay, that's all he could do, and they're not gonna fear me with that. So anyway, this man, who was appointed by Bush 1, overstepped his boundaries, because the Constitution is as it's written, the stream must not be allowed to overstep its bank. But this man overstepped its bank, because I'm the bank, the people are the bank, the government are the stream, the judges, they are the stream, we are the banks, and the stream must never be allowed to overflow its banks. The judges, they have their set of rules which they must not overstep. The people enacted the Constitution, the people appointed for these judges to be judges, the people. So when the people sue the government to seek a redress, the court have a duty not to overstep the citizen. And I have dual nationality. So yes, I'm a citizen. I have British citizenship and I have American citizenship. I have dual citizenship. So the stream must not overstep its bank. And Mr. Rothschild, that's why I'm coming for you in London. Because I have British citizenship also, okay? So I could come for you. Okay? I have a visa. I mean, I don't need a visa. I could come for you when I'm ready for you. Unless we bring you over here to America. So anyway, the stream shall not overstep its banks. And this judge overstepped its bank and ruled. Didn't allow the government to answer the complaint, ruled on behalf of the government. So I appealed. And they tried everything in their power to get this appeal not to go through. But the First Circuit Court allowed the appeal to go through. They gave me until April 25th, 2011 to file my brief. I did the brief in one day, because people, I almost gave up. I knew that they were going to rule against me. So I said, you know something? Why even bother? And then one day, I had put up a video with Bob Marley. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Don't give up the fight. So when I was listening to that, looking at the video, and I know he was talking to me, telling me, no, don't give up the case. Don't give it up. Don't give it up. So on April 25th, I woke up and I wrote the brief. And I told the judge plain out, I said, listen, you can fight against Paul McLeod, you all want. But I'm just here to stop you all from the slaughter that your people gonna bring against you. I told them the people gonna slaughter them because people, I see this vision. I'm not threatening these judges. I would never do that. I don't want no bloodshed, and that's why I sue them, because I do not like bloodshed. So I don't want anybody to say I'm threatening these judges. I'm just seeing, I'm just calling how I see it. When you oppress people, when you turn your back on your people, history tells you the people are going to rise up against and they're going to slaughter you. It's happening in Libya. It's happening in Tunisia. It's happening in Egypt. It's a natural phenomenon. Which one of you can pour concrete over grass? Pour some wet concrete over grass and leave it, and I guarantee you, over time, the grass gonna bust forth and break the concrete and split and come back up. You cannot keep nature down. And you see the spirit of man? It's a free nature. So I'm not threatening these judges. I don't want to say, oh, I'm threatening these judges' life. I'm threatening them with revolution. I'm just calling how I see it. You cannot keep giving people bullshit and expect them not to turn against you. If you spit in the air, it's gonna fall back in your face. Okay, if you corner a little rat into a corner, okay, it's gonna jump in your face and rip your face apart to get away. It's a natural phenomenon. Okay, you just can't hold the spirit of freedom down. Okay, no power, not by might. No power, not by force of will, can steal the wrath of a people's vengeance. Only when justice over the lay the land, and men are free from fear, and free of want, the spirit of revolution will never bow down to my man. Never. So I'm not threatening these judges. I'm just calling how I see it. I just have the ability to see things. I look at things. I see things. I'm not happy with what I see. Sometimes I weep. Sometimes I weep for the thing I see. And I say, my Lord, no, I cannot show them that. He said, do my will. Don't question me. Do it. And I have to. Because if I don't, woe be unto you all. Okay? The chastisement of your peace is in my hands. You have to go and laugh all the other one. Read Isaiah chapter 53. That's me. The chastisement of your peace is in my hands. But these men fight me. I don't try to use mind control on them. I want them to, my Lord want them to judge freely. We don't want to force no one to do anything our will. It's called free will. Free will. Love. No one can force you to love another man. Because as soon as you get a chance, you're going to hate him again. You're going to pretend that you love him. Okay? Man to man. It's so unjust, children. Y'all don't know who to trust. Your worst enemy could be your best friend. And your best friend, your worst enemy. So, anyway, I'm going out of track right now. So, the point I'm trying to make, right, people, is that I saw these guys to force them to get up and start helping the people. And they fought me. So, April 25th, I filed my brief and I told them, you can fight against me all you want, but I'm just here to save you from the people slaughtering you. So, be my guest. Then I quote some stuff off the wall of the court. And I showed them that they didn't believe in justice, because why would they have all this stuff written on the wall of the court? All this stuff, all these little plaques they have on the wall of the court. But yet, everything they're doing against me goes against everything that's on the wall of their court. So I showed it to them, I threw it in their face. And I said, what have we here now? Should my last and a lightning strike to erase the inscriptions off the walls? Maybe I didn't say it in this brief, but I know I said it to them in another motion. I did tell them that. Should my last lightning strike to erase the inscription off the walls? He sent a tornado out west. Okay. Because when you're going to come into our neighborhoods and desecrate it, then maybe we should bring it to your neighborhoods. It's a war of attrition. I don't care who won't get mad at me. When you come into these poor neighborhoods and desecrate them, then why not? Why shouldn't my Lord come into your neighborhood and desecrate yours? And you see the ways of the Lord are unfair. Oh, house of Rothschild, it is your ways which are unfair. Okay? It is your ways which are unfair. What you think? That you're going to just go through this and do your will. Go through this and harm the people and do everything you want and you're never going to pay for it? That's what you thought and you thought wrong. You created this reality. You have created it. In your Bible, you wrote. In your Revelation, you wrote that this was going to happen. What's happening now? You wrote that. So if you wrote it to trick the people, guess what? Paul Muckland is God and his Lord. Because you created God too. So Paul Muckland is Lord. He's going to turn your foolishness into reality. You created a Nibiru for the people. We're going to bring you a Nibiru. You create a Messiah for the people. We're going to bring you a Messiah. You create Doomsday. We're going to bring you a Doomsday. But it's going to come to you. It's going to come to the place that you don't want it to come. Okay? So don't think you're going to create this stuff to destroy the poor and to trap the people and you're going to get away with it. Because guess what? The creators are here. And we're going to create you a reality. The same one you created for the people, we're going to put you in it. Whosoever diggeth a pit shall fall in it. When you spit in the air, it's going to fall back in your face. So, I filed my brief, and the court ordered them to file their brief, a reply brief, by May 31st, 2011. But between May 21st and May 24th, well, actually, May 13th and May 24th, people, I swear to you, hours of jets passing over my house, dumping chemtrails, creating turbulence. And I was wondering, why the hell are they doing that? I know they were dropping chemtrails, but I will later learn that they could use jet air engine to create tornadoes. So these bastards was trying to create tornadoes above my house.
Crackton has heard. That's what they were doing. Microwaves at storms, even blowing jet engine air.
Listen to this.
Crackton says stopping tornadoes is serious business. In order.
So we see that they can create tornado, and they were using these jets to create tornado above my house. And then on May 21st, the Pope, or was it May 22nd, whichever day it was, the Pope called to the International Station, Space Station, and gave them some kind of signal. And how is it so happened that Obama was in England on the 24th, doing their voodoo also, and then Obama signed the wrong date, May 24th, 2008, instead of May 24th, 2011. And when I check it out, on May 24th, 2008, a tornado struck Oklahoma, and then I check it out on May 24th, 2011, the same tornado struck Oklahoma. So it's like these people are messing with the time, like they're turning time back. And people have noticed for the past couple of times, every time I try to make a video with you, I will say one date, and every time I go, I swear to you, when I go back and check back, it's another date. I'm like, I said, is these people are they messing with my mind? Because I swear, when I first start make a video the other day, I said June 6, 2011. When I went back, it said June 6, 2006. I made another video, and I said June 4th, and it says 2011, it says 2006 again. So every time I say something, you keep going back to the time. So I don't know what's happening. But anyway, these people are messing with time. Okay, they're trying to mess with time. They're doing something. So anyway, they were trying to assassinate me, because they were trying to assassinate me between May 21st and May 24th for 3 days, as Isaiah chapter 52 tell you. 3 days, okay, 3 days they had me dead.
But others,
they were bombarding me.
That once you start, okay, modifying the weather,
so when May 21st came now and I wasn't dead, they panicked.
Direction to another state,
and
it's the law
Bush and Obama switch attorneys,
and you may not
like I'm a fool.
The
attorneys work in the same office. It's a U.S. attorney, but they try to play slick and talk about they switch new attorneys and the attorney file appearance, like I'm supposed to fall for that trick. No. It's the same office. You all work together. You didn't switch an attorney. You just did it because you're trying to ask for more time. So, truth to the word now, in came another motion. They filed a motion. First, they filed a motion to throw out the case, saying that the judge should the First Circuit Court should uphold the district court ruling. And basically, they try to throw the blame to the states. I didn't read the motion. I just looked through it because I know it was a bunch of garbage. But I looked through it real quickly. And I think they're trying to blame the states for the fraud. They're trying to say I blame the state. Whatever they're trying to say, I didn't read it. But anyway, they filed that motion. Then they filed a motion to extend time, saying that if the court didn't dismiss the case, then the court should give him time. With the audacity. But the law says that they are not allowed any time to extend. They're not allowed time to extend any extension of time without good cause. So which means if they're gonna ask for extension of time, they have to show good cause. They haven't showed any good cause. They didn't even say when we get a new attorney. They didn't even say that. They just boldly put it in there. We file new appearance. But they file no cause. They showed no cause why they should get time to extend. So therefore they lost the case. They are in default. But the clerk, see, my clerk was out. Adam, he's the clerk on the case, but he was out. So they got the order came in on May 31st. June 1st, the clerk gonna grant it. We don't even give me a chance to object. They just grant it. Grant Bush and Obama extension of time. So as you all know, I called a clerk, and a different clerk answered. He told to file a motion for extension of, motion for consideration. So again, June 6th, people, when Adam came back, now I called. And I said to Adam, I told Adam what they did to me, and I said, but Adam, the 50 governors did not file any. In the brief, and they didn't file any motion to extend time. So, can you default them? So they say, hold up, let me check that out. So Adam, he went and he checked the file. He said, oh, you're right. They didn't file anything. I said, so can you default them? He said, of course I could do that. I mean, that's Adam for you. His name is Adam Sparrow, and you know Adam and Sparrow. You know, the sparrow is a phoenix also, right? So he got that ancient name, Adam and Sparrow. He represent Osiris. He represent Earth. So anyway, Adam said, I can do that. So he checked the files, and at about 9:30, at 10:55 a.m. Eastern Time, I got this note. He said the following transaction was entered on 6/6/2011 at 10:53 a.m. EDT and filed on 6/6/2011. Case name: Merkel versus U.S. et al. Case number: order entered as to appellant, and he names all the 50 governors, right? And this is what it says right here. So people, you all know what this means? This means that we won. Okay, because the district court judge ruled on behalf of the 50 governors and then George Bush and Obama and their treasury secretaries. But when you file an appeal, the appeals court is obligated to look at the case de novo, which means that whatever the district court says, it's not valid anymore. It was never made. It's thrown out. We start afresh. But the governor, I have to argue why the district court was wrong, and it's up to the government to argue why the district court is right. But if they do not file a reply, it means that they're in default. And if they're in default, it means that they cannot be heard. They will not be heard. So if you cannot be heard, that means you cannot put up an argument. That means everything I ask for must be granted to me. Everything I ask for, it's a law. It has to be granted to me. No matter how ridiculous my complaint was, no matter how ridiculous it was, you defaulted, so you lost by default. So people, so great, beautiful my lord is, my lord know that we could never beat these people because the judges are on their side. Everybody's on their side. So what my lord did, my lord confused them. He made them think that they could murder me. He made them think that they could murder me. And my brief, I wrote a brief in one day, people, and the brief was so tight. I'm not trying to brag, but it was so beautiful said that they had no answer to it. They were responsible for the fraud against their own people. The governors did not stand for their people. They were responsible for their fraud. Sarah Palin, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and all these other governors, these clowns out there who are running around talking about they want to run for president, and all these clowns, they were part of your demise. All these governors, every single one of them who was in power under Bush and who are in power now, they are all responsible for your demise. But yet you run around and you praise them and you help them and you support them, and they didn't even stand up for you. Like lambs to the slaughter. Okay? So especially all you Palin lovers out there, she stood silent. How many houses people in Alaska lose their house to? And all these governors who are running for president. Did you stand for your people? Democrat and Republican. Did you stand for your people when they're losing their homes? No, you did not. So people, in the complaint, what I asked for, I asked that the court order these governors to order an immediate cease and desist order against all foreclosures in their state. The lawsuit also goes to the current governors. So not just the ones who are gone. It's for the current and the past governors. So the ones who are in power now, they inherit the lawsuit. So which means that they're going to be under order to order cease and desist of every foreclosure in your state. That's just a start, because when I'm getting to make sure everybody get their homes back. Everybody who lost their homes, I'll make sure they get their homes back, because I own Rothschild Bank now. See, Rothschild Bank defaulted lots of people, so I own that bank now. Everything I ask for must be given to me, and I'm gonna ask that it be dismantled. Every mortgage that bank owns return to the people free and clear of all incumbent. Okay, so anyway, these governors, my lawsuit asks that there is a cease and desist order of all foreclosure in this state. So which means I'm gonna draft a motion, and people, the court is under an obligation. The court is under obligation to enforce a cease and desist order against all foreclosures in your states. Okay. People, when the Constitution was enacted, it made it so that if a court gave a wrong order, if the court gave an order which goes against the Constitution, the people have a right to stand against the court and assault it. And the police, the marshal, the police and the marshal and the sheriff, they are under the Constitution. They have to back up the citizen. If a court ordered them to take you home and you assault the judge, the police have to back you up. And if you get arrested, the jury have to acquit you. And they have to compensate you because you're sending the Constitution. A judge is not allowed to make bad rulings. A judge is not permitted to violate the Constitution. And the police and the sheriff have no authority to stand up for any judge that violates the United States Constitution. So when the judge is going around and passing out foreclosure notices, they are violating the United States Constitution. And the police are under obligation to arrest these judges. Just like they started doing in England. Okay. The US Marshal is under an obligation to arrest Judge Woodlock for allowing the United States economy to fail. Because I asked him to help and he did not. Because he made a wrong ruling. Okay. Any citizen have a right to arrest Judge Woodlock for what he did by failing to stand for the people. And the sheriff, the United States Marshal have an obligation to back up that person. It's in the United States Constitution. It was made in there. It's not there no more because they took it out. But the language is there for it. Okay? Because too many people got hurt. People commit suicide. Lives got lost over this when it didn't have to happen. And they look at me with scorn and fight against me because I'm from the truth. And you're gonna blame me? You call me evil when I build on tornadoes and destruction on you? So what have we here now? Should I just sit back and allow you to abuse me and abuse the people and nothing come of it? So the federal marshal is under obligation to arrest any judge that make any wrong ruling. They're under obligation to do it under the United States Constitution, because the stream must never be allowed to overstep its banks. So therefore, I'm going to write a motion. I'm going to write for these judges to grant judgment. Okay. That these governors order an immediate stop to every single foreclosure in the country, and Begin the order of having people put back in their homes who lost their homes. But the letter for that, the first step is the cease and desist order. And George Bush and them, the federal marshal is under an obligation to arrest George Bush, arrest Henry Snow, arrest Barack Obama and Geithner. They came in, they got to get a little pass with the top because in a way they helped some American corporation, but they still commit treason. So they're not going to escape fully yet, because they still have a chance to fix their mess. So I'm going to watch them a little bit. But right now, the federal marshal is under obligation to arrest George Bush. He committed treason by bailing out these foreign banksters. The federal marshal is under obligation to arrest Henry Snow, arrest the Treasury Secretary who was under George Bush. He was under an obligation to arrest them for treason, for bailing out these crooks, knowing that they committed fraud against all the people. Barack Obama is an obligation to all the federal marshals to arrest Bush. Because when Barack Obama failed his duty to order the federal marshals to arrest Bush, then Barack Obama is aiding and abetting in Bush escaping liability. So that makes Barack Obama an accomplice to Bush. The federal marshal is an obligation, okay, to defend the citizens. When we walk into a court, the federal marshal is an obligation not to escort me like I'm a criminal, but to escort me as a citizen who going to stand for him, because he's just like me. They'll throw him to the dogs just like they throw me to the dogs. They're just using the federal marshal to protect them. Okay, use us against each other. That's what they do, because the federal marshal, they're one of us. They're us. They're part of us. But they use them. But the federal marshal, they have families too. You have cousins and uncles. You have blood relatives out there who are suffering just like us. Come on, stand up with us. We're not trying to overthrow the government. We're trying to hold the government accountable. We're not trying to hurt anybody. We're trying to put the criminals in jail. Those who are complacent, we're trying to put them in jail so we can move our country forward. We're not going to move forward if you all just sit by and come and arrest Paul Merkel because Paul Merkel speak out. We ain't going to get nowhere. We're just going to get severe storms. That's the only thing we're going to accomplish by messing with Paul Merkel. Tornadoes and terrible earthquakes, because as you all, as they will tell you all, it's set in motion already, because the day I start breathing, the earth will stop too, because you know why? I can create. Okay, my Lord have taught me, I can create. When I shut, no man shall open. And I will set in motion. It's already set in motion. So, if they think they could kill me and get away with it, they will die too. But their death will be 10 times as horrible as anything that they could ever inflict on me. That's not a threat. I'm telling you, if you kill me, revenge is mine, said the Lord. So, the federal marshals, they had an obligation to stand with me, to help me. So now, people, what I'm saying is, by default, these banks have no authority to collect 1 cent in mortgage payments from you. Let the revolution begin. People of America, the federal marshal have an obligation to stop next to you and say no. These banks committed fraud. They have no right to collect any mortgage payment from you. These banks have no right to foreclose on your property and sell it. They violated the United States Constitution. The banks got paid with the bailout, because the bailout was compensation. Because they said we commit fraud against them. They said the people gave them false income. They blame the people. They say we bought a house we couldn't afford. They blame us. So we bail them out. So that means you got paid for the mortgages. And you had insurance on them anyway. So you got paid like 3 times. So why the frig are you still collecting mortgage payments from us? People decided to stamp against Mr. Rothschild. Stop paying your mortgage. If you pay your mortgage, then guess what? You have a debt. Guess what? What you get, you deserve. People, I'm sure you are right here. They defaulted. Which means, we won. I did this for you. I stood up for you. Don't let me down. Don't make me look like a fool and keep paying your mortgages. Don't make me look like a fool and get up. When these people tell you, yes, you'll move. Because, yo, if you all let me down, I'm going to shake this world. Go and laugh and think, I'm going to shake it. I will shake this world if you all let me down. Okay? So when this time start coming in your neighborhoods, don't wonder why. Because a lot of people suffer for you guys. A lot of people suffered. The people in the foreclosure hamlet, Tony Webster, Jim Brody, Dave in Florida, I can't pronounce his last name, I know he's going to be mad at me, Dave, Changa, the Lightning Man, Lisa. I mean, a lot of people suffer a lot for you guys. These people were the only one who stood with me when no one knew what I was doing. These people are the ones who came up with their $455 to pay the filing fee that the court said they're going to throw out the case if I didn't pay. They paid it. They paid it. And these people have been standing for me for a few years. And even before I knew them, they've been in court fighting for you guys. Fighting when you guys didn't know them. You guys don't even know it. A small group of people. It's a group called Foreclosure Hamlet. They've been fighting for you guys. For millions of you guys standing up and fighting for you guys. And you guys didn't even know it. Don't let us down. Do not let us down. Stop paying your mortgage. I want to say respect to my friend Tony Webster, Jim Brody, Dave Changa, you know, all those who stood with me, those who never doubted me. Thank you. And these guys are in Florida and Colorado, different states. And there are others, but right now, the names is not at the top of my head right now. And I don't mean to be forgetful, but you know, you guys know who you are, and I'm sure they don't need. In time, we are gonna get recognition. In time, you are gonna get recognition. In time, so you all, everyone who supported me and stood with me, you know who you are. In time, you'll get your recognition. Okay, I will share this part with the strong. Okay, so know that. And so a lot of people suffered for you guys. We got embarrassed. I mean, they ridiculed us. They call us crazy. They call us all kind of names. So we fought a hard battle for you guys. And now I'm asking, don't let us down, please. Please. Okay, just stand up for yourself. Stand up. Don't pay your mortgage. They have no authority to foreclose on your people. I will not tell you a lie. I haven't paid my mortgage in 4 years. People, the last time I paid this bank mortgage was April 11, 2007. I paid them $5,781. That was it. Because when they raised my mortgage to $3,000, my mortgage was $2,067.94. When I made them that payment, $5,781, they raised my payment to $3,833. I said, hell no, I'm not paying this. And from then, I haven't paid anything. And they can never take my house. And they will never, people, they will never get a penny from me from this house. And they will never take my house. It will be over my dead body. It will be over my dead body. They will take this house from me. Ready for dead. Not for the house. But on my principle that these men commit fraud. And I'll be damned. I will be damned if I allow you to take something from me fraudulently while I'm alive and while I'm living and free. Are you kidding me? You have to lock me in prison for the rest of my life to think you could take my home from me and get away with it. Really, I will come back at you. Are you kidding me? Give me liberty and give me death. Okay, this, you take this house from me, it will be like the curse that you wish you had never, ever come across. Okay, I will hunt you. And even if you kill me, my spirit will hunt you. I will hunt you. I'll massacre you. Foreign bank says, listen to me. You take my house, Mr. Rothschild. You take my house, I will hunt you. I will hunt you personally. I will hunt you. All your security guards in the world couldn't stop me. I will hunt you. I will hunt you. I will hunt you. Nothing the demons in hell could stop me from you. And those who help you, woe be unto them. I don't feel what no man could do to me. I got the power of the people and the power of the Lord on my side. The people, they're not on my side yet, but sooner or later they're gonna wake up and they're gonna be with me, because they're gonna realize that I've been telling the truth all along. So people, this is my birthday gift to you. Stop paying your mortgages. Stop paying your mortgage. Stand on your 2 feet like a man. Stand up like a woman. Start taking back control of your life. Taking back your mortgage, your house, is the first step. Because the economy is based on your homes. It's not your, this is an American economy. This is your style economy, because your mortgage is based on the labor. The labor is in London market. Check your mortgage note, you see. Check your mortgage note. Okay. The performance of the interest rate on your mortgage is based on the labor. LIBOR. Okay. The London market, where Mr. Rothschild resides. Okay. He's over collapsing your economy by raising. He messed with the labor. He adjusted how he see fit. Take your homes. Stop paying Mr. Rothschild mortgage. It's a lie. Your home does not help the U.S. economy. People, it's a freaking lie. Your homes do not help the U.S. economy. Your homes help the labor. The London market that Mr. Rothschild owns. Look on your mortgage note if you think I'm lying. Look on your promissory note. Look on your promissory note. It will say the labor. LIBOR. At least it's on the adjustable rate. There are about 10 million adjustable rate mortgages out there. And on all those 10 million adjustable rate mortgage, it says the performance of your note is based on the labor. For conventional mortgages, I don't know if it's the same thing, but I will suspect. Look on your promissory note and you see if it's on there. That's Mr. Rothschild Bank. That's his market. So your mortgages, your payments are going to Mr. Rothschild Bank. Your mortgages have nothing to do with the American economy. The securities of the mortgages are based on the American economy. But how can that be if the promissory note is based on it? Because you know why? Because the mortgage they collect from you goes to Mr. Rothschild Bank. But the securities that are attached to the market, to the mortgages, which are supposed to be the interest rate. Okay? So the securities are based on the interest rate, the interest of the parent, not on the mortgage, not on the principal, but on the interest. So when they mess with the interest, right, and raise the interest rate, and you can't afford to pay your mortgage, guess who suffer? The United States economy, because the performance of the securities are based on the interest rate. So while his bank collect the principal, right, and the principal, because remember, you in adjustable mortgages, the interest rate are raised after 2 years. So the principal interest rate you're paying, Mr. Rothschild is getting that. He getting that on the principal. The interest is supposed to go to support these securities. They're non-existent, they're phantom. So it's creating phantom profits. So all these banks now are there putting on their books that they're making out of the future profits. Oh, we know the interest rate is supposed to be raised in 2 years, right? They're claiming it in before it even come. So instead of waiting for 2 years to cut interest rate, they're saying, oh, we're making that today. So they're making a phantom profit. So on the books, you look at these banks are making money. They're not making any money. They are speculating. They are speculating that when they raise the mortgage in 2 years, when the interest rate goes up, or whenever the interest rate goes up and they raise the mortgage, that they're going to collect this kind of money. So they are creating phantom profit. And when time comes, Mr. Rothschild collapses the market, and guess what? The banks are bankrupt because guess what? They have no money coming in. They reported profits that were 2 years in the making that they weren't gonna collect for the next 2 years. So that's what they get for messing with Mr. Rothschild. So what I'm saying, people, if y'all wanna be fools and keep paying your mortgage, that's your business. But the United States Marshal, the sheriff, the police, you all have families too. You all have friends who are suffering. Wow. They cannot fire you if you stand for the law. Mr. Policeman, Mr. Federal Marshal, Mr. Sheriff, if you get an order to carry out an eviction notice and you say you cannot do it and they fire you, how many of you federal officers do you think gonna back you up? Every single one of them, if they have a heart, will back you up. So how can they fire you? They're gonna fire the entire force? They will have no force. People, why can't we realize that we are the power? They use us to control us. They are so slick. Pit brother against brother. Pit the black man against the white man. Because separated, they are weak. People, Earth is like a rainbow planet. No, Earth is a rainbow planet. The white people, the black people, the yellow people, the red people, we make up the rainbow planet. Until Mr. Rothschild and his twin came out of nowhere and pretend that they, one people or another, inbreed with the Canaanites and made the Canaanites change their name and call themselves Jews and that kind of mix up. Inbreed with these people and then separate us, trick us, make us think that we are better than each other, create capitalism, create money, create the monetary system when everything was for all. Because if you can think about this story, when there was a famine in all the world and they went into Egypt, when they went into Egypt, they fed everyone. I mean, you can tell from that story that it was a thing like a brotherhood. So this Rothschild came in and pit nation against nation, color against color, people against people. Created gods and gave them to us to worship. Created gods, gave us to worship, and created demons and gave them to us to fear. So people, time to stand up against the devil. I have identified the devil for you. Mr. Evelyn Rothschild and his clan, they are the devil. Okay. They're the devil. Mr. Evelyn Rothschild, his family, that bloodline of the Satan. Pope Benedict, his bloodline of Satan. The devil. They work hand in hand. They're brothers. I will take my staff bond and cut it in two. So I'm going to break the brotherhood between Mr. Rothschild and Pope Benedict. People of America, people in England, you all need to stop and stop paying your mortgages too. They can't fraud against you also. People in France, Germany. Wow. This man have his hand in every single piece of business transaction in the world. Americans, stand up. I call upon the sheriff, the police, the federal marshals, and call upon you to support the people and arrest any bankster, any attorney, any foreclosing entity, or even any judge that try to take foreclosure on the people's property. As of now, you stand on the law. And people, if anyone come and take your house, you have a right to assault them, and the police have an obligation to back you up. And if you get arrested under the law, you must be acquitted and be compensated for. It's a law. It can be interpreted in the United States Constitution. Okay, so let's start taking our country back. And the way to take it back is to defend your home. Defend your home. And how do you defend your home? By taking it away from Mr. Rothschild and the Labour and Wall Street. Take your house away from them. Liberate your home. I and I liberate Zimbabwe. Bob Marley said, I and I liberate Zimbabwe. You know what Zimbabwe mean? Houses. Houses of stones. Okay. See, you all think Bob Marley was speaking about his time. Bob Marley wasn't speaking about his time. Bob Marley was speaking about the future. Bob Marley wasn't speaking about Selassie. Bob Marley was speaking about Paul Merkel. It was just a cover up. It was a cover. You see, I know. I want you to know he was just a cover. Selassie was my shield. Okay? He was my shield so that I could grow. I could grow and they would never have a clue who I was. So the focus was put on him so they could think it was him. And truth to what, they killed him because they thought it was. They killed him. So Baba and Selassie, Tears was in this together. Okay? The Trinity was in this together. Okay? You were all up front. Selassie was my shield. So what I'm saying is that. People, I don't want to rule you. I have no desire to be a ruler. I don't want you to follow me. I want you to stand for yourself. I and I liberate Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe means house of stones. Okay. I came to liberate your homes. Houses of stones. That's what it means. And Zimbabwe is America because thousands of years ago, over 3,000 years ago, the Africans migrated from Egypt and Africa, migrated to America, and they built pyramids in Egypt and pyramids in America. For what? For guidance. It's in Genesis where they said, come let us build us a city whose tower reaches to the heaven. So that we may not be scattered abroad. What that means, they're saying, let us build signs. Let us build something that we could use to map the stars so that we could travel. And we won't be lost. We won't be scattered abroad. So they build the pyramids in America. And they build them in Europe. And they build them in Egypt. And they align them with the stars so they know where to find each other. So what, brothers and sisters? That's why they say they have pyramids in Europe. Because the white man, the black man, the red man, and the yellow man, we were all united by these pyramids. We united. We used them to find each other. And then the Rothschild came and separated us. We were one. The rainbow planet. The black man, the white man, the red man, the yellow man. We all migrated from Africa, some migrated to Europe, some to America, and all over, and they built pyramids which were aligned with the stars so that we may not be scattered abroad. And then Mr. Russell Cameron said, ha, look at men, they have built them a city. Now nothing that the desire shall be withheld from them. Come on, demons, let's go down and confuse your language so that they may not understand one another. So Mr. Russian and the demons came down and scattered us abroad. Scattered us. We were lost. Okay. So the pyramids, so they destroyed the Mayans, destroyed the Egyptians, and they destroyed the ancient Europeans, destroyed the ancient Japanese, just destroyed everybody else who knew the truth. And tricked the offsprings with lies. Come, let's go down and confuse your language so they may not understand one another. Because we all spoke one language. The pyramid text, that's how we spoke. But they gave us their words, you know. We used to read from left to right. Okay? I'm sorry, we used to read from right to left. Now they have us reading from right. We used to read from right to left. Now they have us reading from left to right. Because they turn the world around. Okay? They are turning the world around. And that's why the world is like this, because they read the text, the Egyptian text, backwards. That's why when I interpret the Bible, I don't read the Bible how you guys read it. I read the Bible from left, from right to left, and I interpret it from right to left. If you say A, I know it means B. Okay? If you say black, I know it means white. Because they turn it around. So, my point being, people, time to stop against Mr. Rothschild. And my birthday gift to you, stop paying your mortgages. The sheriff, the police, they have an obligation to stop to you. Because if they fail in their duty, then the military, the United States military, okay, you have family members who are suffering, who got taken advantage of by these banks. Okay, the National Guard, you are authorized, because the Second Amendment say for a free state, okay, a well-regulated militia shall be established for a free state. And the National Guard, you are that well-regulated militia. You are not obligation to even arrest these sheriffs if they don't, if they try to evict people of their homes. And when the federal marshal and the police and the sheriff fail in their duty to help the people, you are not obligation to arrest them. You are under an obligation to help the people, National Guard. And when you're failing your duty, the active military have an obligation to help the people. The active military under the United States Constitution, the active military have a duty and an obligation to their family and to the people to stop these banks from taking our homes and to arrest anyone who is complacent. You have an obligation to do that. And the Joint Chiefs of Staff, he's a civilian. He's not an elected government official, so therefore he has an obligation to call upon the military to help the people from being victimized by these foreign banksters. Okay? And when the active military fail to help the people, then you see the militias down south, those who are in the woods and in the bushes, those gun rights advocates, and other people who have guns. If the military in the end fail to help you, guess what? Under the Second Amendment, you have a right to be armed for your free state, and not to pay your mortgages, and not to let anyone take your homes. Of course, they're gonna send their goons. They might send their goons to arrest me, say I'm some revolution. But it's okay, people. I'm ready for this. Ready to die for this. I am, truly am. But I say it because I know I'm not gonna die, so I could say it. I'm not afraid of these men. How can I be afraid of death when I could walk down my stairs and fall and break my neck? I mean, people, do you know how many times I trip on my stairs and I should have really fell and broke my neck, but for some reason I didn't? Because he shall send his angel to take charge over you. That if you should stumble, they should catch you before you fall. Something like that. The point I'm trying to make is that I could walk out in the street and get hit by a truck. So why should I try to preserve my life out of fear of these men doing harm to me? Why should I fear to stand up for what's right, out of fear of losing my life, when I could go to sleep tonight and don't wake up in the morning? So you see, there's nothing to fear but fear itself. We are gonna die anyway, and I'd rather die for a good cause than to die living a lie. So enough be talking about death. People of America, I'm asking you, I'm pleading with you. It's time to let your government know that you have a voice. Time to let your voice be heard. There's many ways you could do it. The battle is not for the strong alone. It's for the vigilant, the active, and the brave. Okay? Petition. Okay? March around Washington, D.C. March around your governor's office. March. Sing. You know what I'm saying? Beat your plowshares into swords, and you're pulling hooks into spears. Let the weak say I'm strong. Okay? It's time for the militiamen to start gathering. Start gathering to start defending your communities from these banksters. Because if the police, if you're not feeling the duty to protect the citizen, then it's up to you militias to do it. And you don't have to be a militia, you don't have to have a gun. Beat your plowshares into swords, and you're putting hooks into spears. Okay? Why don't they kill all of us? And why would the police come and fight us? Why would the sheriff and the masters come and fight against us when they are one of us? Pitting brother against brother. People, it's not you against Paul Muckley. It's not Paul Muckley against the United States of America. It's Paul Muckley against Mr. Rothschild government, the financial oligarchy. Okay? That's who I'm against. Okay? It's time to free our country from the hands of the financial oligarch. Okay? Mr. Rothschild in London City. So in ending, my people, defend your home, America, and get up, stand up. Stand up for your rights. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Most people think great God will come from the sky, take away everything and make everybody feel high. But if you know what life is worth, you would look for your Messiah on earth. So now you see the light. Stand up for your right. Yeah. Get up, stand up. One love, my people. Get up and stand up for your right. Because if you don't, if you don't, woe be unto you. Because the alternative is going to be draconic. One love. A lot of us have spoken. I'm out.